Hi, welcome to the lecture on gender and aging. I won't be doing a video lecture for global stratification, so you'll want to get that from the textbook, and I'll be posting shortly in the course materials some notes that will let you know what is being emphasized, what you need to look for in that chapter. Okay, so first we'll start with gender. Now, a common confusion is that sociology has very specific definitions of gender and sex. They're two different things. Sex is chromosomal. And here's where I'm going to give you more and more up-to-date information than your book has, although these facts have been known for a long time amongst biological scientists. Sex refers to biological characteristics encoded in your chromosomes. So if you have two X chromosomes, you're female, biologically. If you have an XY set of chromosome pairs, you are male, biologically. Those pairs trigger hormones and brain development that make you appear as male or female. Now, here's what biologists know, and that doesn't get brought up in introduction classes, is that there are two more gender possibilities. There's XXY, where there's an extra chromosome, and there's XYY, where there's an extra chromosome. What do these mean? Well, to biologists, biologists will tell you, well, nature doesn't like strict rules. That's why you get variation. When plants pollinate, you get different colors. Nature doesn't like a fast rule. Nature is recombining those chromosomes in whichever way that it wants to. And you actually end up with four different chromosome profiles. And so the point to all of this is to let you know that even biological sex is a continuum. So there's clear-cut females, which are XX, clear-cut males, which are XY, and then these two that we don't really understand very much in the general public, XXY and XYY. Biological gender isn't a binary. Our culture says that there are only two. But no, it's a spectrum, and there are at least four versions of this. Now, gender is a cultural or social spectrum. Gender is the status, role, and expectations attached to the biological sex that you have. Now, you can see how this would cause problems for transgender people, people who felt like they were born in the same body, who have what our society calls abnormal, but to nature is completely acceptable chromosomal variations. You can read about that in the book. There's an example of a child who had to have a gender assignment surgery and it didn't work. Something was recently in the news about that too, this is what happens. Mom's in the hospital, lying in the delivery room, and the baby comes out. Mom says, is it a boy or a girl? And the doctor says, we'll talk later, because it's not clear. Sometimes babies are born with both physical structures, one underdeveloped, one undeveloped. Sometimes just genital abnormalities where they don't need to do any genetic testing to know that there's something going on with the chromosomes. So there is a spectrum there. And gender is attached to sex. It's like sex is a status and gender is the role you're supposed to play. So, you know, men are supposed to be strong and aggressive and, you know, protectors and make the money. That's the stereotype. And women are supposed to be quiet and nurturing and sweet and not able to throw a ball, a baseball. And these role expectations really in our culture play out to a set of stereotypes. I was in a store the other day and I looked down the aisle to see if it was the aisle I wanted, and I saw this massive explosion of pink and there was a clear dividing line, and then bright blue and bright red. It was so striking that I took out my iPhone and I took a picture of it to use in class because it was so striking. And I bet you can already guess what aisle I was looking down. It was the toy aisle. So things are so gendered. And then people typically, market research has found that people learn to like what is presented to them. This may have happened to you if you've ever heard a song on the radio that you just can't stand at first, and then it grows on you and it grows on you, and pretty soon you can't get it out of your head. That's the concept. So our society is very gendered. We have very different roles. Girls are supposed to like pink. So they learn to like pink because everyone around them is telling them to like pink. It doesn't mean that, you know, in that XX chromosome pair that there's anything in those chromosomes that determines color preference for pink. In fact, in other cultures, pink is not associated with female. I may have mentioned this in an earlier lecture. In other countries, for example, babies are dressed in green or yellow, and there aren't any distinctions as to boys' and girls' clothing. Pink and blue happened in the U.S. in the 1950s as a marketing thing. How do you sell more baby clothes? Well, if everybody's wearing the same color baby clothes, no matter what sex they are, you can only sell, you know, one little jumpsuit. But if you have a baby girl, and she's, let's say she's grown up, she's 2 years old, and then you have a baby boy, instead of using the same jumpsuit that you saved, now you have to go buy one in blue because it's a boy. It was a way of selling more clothes. You may find that quite surprising, but that's how that came about. It was not always so. It was simply a way to sell more clothes, and it's come to impact our culture in such a way that we think it's innate. We think, oh, well, yeah, girls like pink. It's like, well, no. Media, culture, and society created this. This is social construction of gender. The society around us constructed the idea that girls like pink and boys like blue or should be dressed in blue. So that's an example of the social construction of gender. It also includes things like what women should do. Like when I say construction worker, you probably don't picture a woman, even though there's great variation between sexes and genders. You know, some women could out-construction some men. I mean, you've got, you know, really slight, tiny men, and you've got some really big, muscular women, and vice versa. Everyone is not the same. So it's our culture that's telling us that women can't be construction workers. It's not in the chromosomes. It's not biologically determined. Okay. Now, our culture has something called the gender binary. There are many other cultures that don't have this. Our culture, despite what the biologists know, our culture says there are only two sexes, male and female, and that's it. Because it's only been recent that we can decode the human genome, so how could we know? But this cultural legacy of thinking as things as all male, all female, is actually inaccurate now. But the term for it is the gender binary, where the society assumes that there are only two, and regardless of your chromosome makeup, you have to fit into one or the other. And people who don't are very discriminated against. Gender, remember last week we talked about structures. A kitchen is a social structure in that it's a set of statuses and roles that provides a structure for what you're supposed to do. Gender is the same thing. Gender is a structure within society. So you can think of gender as both a social construction and as a social structure. Okay. Now, gender roles vary over time and place. Gender roles vary in time and place. you know that relationships between men and women were different in the 1800s than they are now, in the 1400s, in the Stone Age. This changes over time. Even from the 1950s, the world, if you watch the HBO series Mad Men, that's the normal world in 1955, and the early 60s. That's the world that women lived in. It's very different now. Very, very different. All the way down to what people say, what's acceptable, how they dress, all of it. Mad Men is a great example of how it changes over time. Now, we live in America, and most of Western culture, and Eastern culture actually, lives under a system called patriarchy. Patriarchy is a social system that has evolved over human time, where men run society, inheritance rules favor men, women lose their last names and take on their husband's name when they get married. Women tend to be secondary in decision-making or have no decision-making. Sometimes women in history were considered the property of the husband. In fact, the Romans considered the father to own the family, and he could kill them if he wanted to. That was in Roman law. So, you know, you don't do something dad likes. It was perfectly within the law for dad to take you out back and chop off your head. That's extreme patriarchy. And since most of Western culture is based on Roman and Greek models, we inherited this patriarchy, although today it still exists, but obviously not in that extremity. Children are known in patriarchy by the father's last name. Now, this varies in Latino culture, where both the mother's and father's last names are included in the naming. So it's different there in terms of naming. But the father's name is added, so that's there. In inheritance and kinship, the male line is more important. Men are the decision makers. That's a system of patriarchy based on gender roles. Now, the opposite of that, which still exists and has existed over history, are matriarchal societies, and which are pretty much opposite of everything I described about patriarchal. Matriarchal societies count kinship through the mother's line. Women hold important decision-making roles. Women can own property. And matriarchal societies tend to be more egalitarian or more equal. I'll be honest, no one really knows why. They just do. just for the observations of anthropologists over the years in different societies. Some great examples of contemporary contemporary matriarchal societies are indigenous groups like the Cherokee Indians of North Carolina and Oklahoma. That is a matriarchy in their traditional structure. Some of the Lakota are also like that. I'm trying to remember if it's the Mandan, the Hidatsu, or the Arikara. But anyway, it's common. And it's common for patriarchal and matriarchal societies to be neighbors, as Native American tribes were before European conquest. And there are many features of matriarchy that are different. There's less warfare. Now, you might think this is somehow biological. I think it's more social, because warfare isn't very good for protecting your children and keeping the species going. You can't keep them going if you're killing the young men all the time. So it might be more of a cultural survival thing. That's a big question. In fact, feel free to make a thread on the discussion board, and maybe we can wrestle with this, respond to each other. Very interesting question. You know, why are matriarchal societies historically less warlike? Why is that? The other things that we know about gender, for example, the stereotype that women aren't good at math and men are better at math, well, that's culturally created. because of how we teach our children, what we expect of them, and what we tell them. In other countries where they teach as if everyone has the ability, the scores are pretty much identical. And so this is an American thing. You may be surprised to learn. There is no innate biological thing that says that women are bad at math. It's that they're taught and told and labeled as being bad at math. Think back to deviance. If you're labeled and you're told something enough, you become that thing. Okay. So far we've covered sex versus gender, sex being a biological spectrum, gender being a socially constructed spectrum of roles that people play according to what society has decided goes along with the sex. They're both continuums. Gender is a structure within society, and the structure that we operate under is the bigger, larger macro structure is patriarchy, where men control decision-making. And there are also matriarchies where women control decision-makings, and those societies still exist today. Okay. Now, in social terms of being a woman, there is a backdrop to a woman's life that a man usually doesn't have to deal with, and that has to do with violence against women. Men have their own challenges that they have to deal with, the pecking order, but women have to deal with rape, honor killing, nobody killed a man because he slept with his neighbor's wife. They kill the woman in honor killing. Domestic violence is mostly against women, although it can be the other way. The greatest majority is against women. Sexual battery, stuff like groping, pinching, catcalling on the street, the threat of rape, the threat of assault, being afraid to walk by those guys who are hooting and hollering. That's part of a woman's backdrop that she's had to deal with since every woman has dealt with this since childhood. You know, it's learned behavior. There's nothing innate in this. This is all cultural. It's all socially constructed. And so that affects how women experience the world. Often we have TV shows like The View, where the women's point of view is supposed to be different. Sometimes it is, but we all remember intersectionality. We all have a constellation of factors that affect how we rule the world. We have our environment, our life circumstances, our biology, everything comes into play. Politically, control of women's bodies is something that women have to worry about and men don't. For example, most insurance companies will pay for Viagra, but they won't pay for contraceptive medicines for women. Think about that for a minute. You can pay in order to make a baby, but they won't pay if that baby gets made and the couple can't afford it. Nobody's paying for that, and they won't pay for the contraception. Interesting way we have things structured. So control over women's bodies in terms of anti-choice legislation, as well as things like female circumcision. Basically, men making decisions for women about what to do with their bodies. Now, some women may be pro-choice, some women may be anti-choice, you know, and that is their political stance. That's why we live in a pluralistic society. Everyone gets to have their stance. But analytically, whether or not you agree with it, when most of the legislatures making these laws are made up of men, it's just a cold, hard fact that the positions are occupied by men. They're primarily responsible for making the laws. There are very few women in the Senate, a little more in the House of Representatives is more even, but the Senate is more powerful. And there are very few women in the Senate. The women that we do have tend to be very high visibility, like Hillary Clinton or Condoleezza Rice. They're very high visibility, but that doesn't mean that there are a lot of women in the Senate. I mean, just look at the news next time they show the Senate. Look at the sea of faces. You'll see a sea of men. Now, I'm not saying men are bad. I mean, that's just silly. I'm pointing out the fact that we have to recognize reality. Reality doesn't always sound nice. It doesn't always sound good. But as sociologists, we suck it up. You know, we just say, that's the way it is. I look at the crowd, I count the people, this is what I see. So don't take this as any kind of anti-male thing, because it's not. It's just looking at the numbers. And if the numbers change, then I'd be lecturing on the numbers that changed. Okay, another thing around the world that women have to deal with is called female genital mutilation or female circumcision. This is done a lot in Africa and some of the Middle East. It takes different forms in different places. You can see more about it in your book. But it's controlling women by around age 8 or 10 without anesthesia. The adults hold down the girl, cut off her clitoris, and sew her vagina shut. That's so that she won't have premarital sex. She will also never have an orgasm, because that's what the clitoris does. She also may die of infections, even if it's done at a doctor's office and she returns to a traditional village where hygiene isn't very well practiced. So when we think of women, we also need to recognize women in third world countries and around the world have problems that are even more basic than American gender inequality. See page 285 in your book for a fuller explanation of all the variations, and we call it FGM, female genital mutilation. Now, this brings us around to the concept of feminism. Most of you probably know feminism as a stereotype. They hate men. They hate men. They burn their bras. You know, they're gay. whatever. In social science, feminism refers to the theorizing of gender. And the underlying idea is that women should have equal social and economic rights as men. So if you believe that a woman should get equal pay for equal work, you're a feminist. You just are. Media stereotypes notwithstanding, that's what feminism actually is. It's the idea that women should have equal rights socially and economically as men do. So it's not about women being better. It's not about men being bad. It's about equality. In fact, I've run into some feminist people who prefer to call the movement equalism. And in Spanish, they talk about equidad, not igualdad. It doesn't mean that igualdad means that you're trying to say that males and females are the same. Obviously, they're not. But equidad means that they have equity, that they have equity in society. And that's how it works with Latin American feminists. So feminism is a varied spectrum. There are a lot of different kinds of feminism. It's kind of beyond the scope of the course for me to go through each one of them for you, but you can get a little bit of the flavor in the book and know that even what the book shows you, there are about eight main feminist theory, versions of feminist theory, and they're not covered in your book. So there's even more out there than is in your book. Okay, so ignore the caricatures. Now here are the facts that make feminism exist. Why does feminism exist? All kinds of women are feminists. It's because of unequal opportunities for women historically. Historically, women were considered property, just like a slave would be. Women could not vote. Women were not supposed to appear in the public streets without a male escort. I'm talking about, 18th, 19th century ideas. It's only very recently that women were given the vote. Slaves were given the right to vote before women were. We had emancipation before we had women voters. If you look at the charts, there's a set of charts on page 290, 291 that sort of show you the numbers and establish, yes, this is a fact. This isn't somebody's opinion. There is gender inequality. It exists. So on the last part, it compares the number of men and the number of women with advanced degrees. And I think it says that the men are 51% have advanced degrees and the women 49%. And that's recent data. And if you can see the historical trend in the chart, but that's recent data. But here's the wrinkle in it, is that with the same qualifications, with the same advanced degree, doing the same job, women still earn only about 70% of what a man earns who has the same qualifications and does the same job. So this is where, and this may be unconscious on people's part, but the social idea that women are worth less somehow economically than men is the reason that feminism, one of the reasons that feminism exists. We don't have equal pay because of this legacy of patriarchy that tends to devalue women. So if you want to see the numbers on pay, look at 292 to 295. Men on average, this is on average, this doesn't mean that you can pull out any individual woman or man and say, well, that man makes more than me, therefore there's no inequality. No, we're talking about everybody in the United States, huge groups of people in the labor force, controlled for all sorts of variables by the Bureau of Labor Statistics. So this is real data. So men on average make more than women regardless of occupation, education, and other factors. It also occurs that women, there are very few, I mean, I don't even think there's double digits. There are very few women CEOs of major corporations in the United States. They are all male. And this is referred to, the process that leads up to that is called the glass ceiling. Whether it's conscious or not, or it's just an unconscious bias, women tend to be seen as being very good in support roles, as assistant this, as administrative that, not in roles like CEO or manager. So they tend not to find mentors in the workplace who will help them advance the way that men do. The social stereotype is that men are more fit to lead. Men are leaders. Women are not considered leaders. And again, I say, this may be completely unconsciously done by the people doing it, but it results in discrimination to the point where we can see the numbers over time so clearly of women stopping at a certain level without being promoted, and we call that the glass ceiling. It's invisible, but it's there. And it's made up of social behaviors and social expectations that people may not even realize that they're being influenced by. And so this is a large pattern over time in statistics. So this is not biological. It's not biological because the women who do end up by luck, chance, and hard work in top executive positions perform just as well as men. So this isn't about their DNA. This is about social stereotypes working against them to produce this barrier where they're considered more as support people than as leaders. A good example of this is world leaders. Australia has a female prime minister. Back in 1980, England had a female prime minister. Lots of countries have female prime ministers, but we have never had a female president. Isn't that a little odd? We're supposed to be the most advanced nation. Even third world countries have had female presidents. Very odd. But you may not have thought about that before, but that's because you're a fish in the water. Society is the water. How can a fish see the water? Okay, now there's subtleties. And also, I'm going to keep on with a political example. Let's say there were a woman running for an important political office, like president, but it could be anything else, city council, whatever. The fact that she's a woman does not necessarily mean that she is going to favor policies that promote equality for women. The same is true of race and ethnicity. And one thing that often comes out is that profit is the stronger influencer. if someone has a vested political or economic interest in a policy that disfavors their demographic, they'll go with that. So just electing a woman is sociologically interesting, but you need to make sure what issues that that woman stands for the same way you would as any man running. It's not enough to be of a demographic category. You need to know where they're coming from on social issues to make your decision anywhere on the political spectrum, wherever you are. Okay. So the last part of the chapter is about aging. And America's population is swelling at the top. They're, because of the baby boom and the post-baby boom, so basically my parents' generation and then my generation, they're aging now. And so we have more elderly than we have ever had before. We are more and more becoming an elderly nation. In 2050, a full 20% of Americans will be 65 or older. 20%, when you're talking about millions of people, that's a big number. Compare that to 12% in the year 2000. You can see how it's rising, how it's going to rise. By 2050, fully half of Americans will be age 39 or older. So this is going to change society. It's already changing society. But we know about how it's changing our society, but how do they do age around the world? In China, the old are revered for their wisdom. They've accumulated years and years of wisdom. In the West, aging is the worst thing you can do, especially for women. Women aren't allowed to get old. An older man gets gray hair, he's distinguished. An older woman gets gray hair, she's old. And old is a bad word for women. We want to look young. It used to be that people lied about their age in order to seem older. Now they lie to be younger. And just one proof of this is the amazing amount of money spent on cosmetic plastic surgery by women and cosmetic injections, to wrinkle injections and things. Now, the changing demographics also have to do with advanced medicine and lower death rates. You know, if we have better medicine, less people die. So that's playing into it too. Now, what society expects of older people affects what they expect of themselves and consequently what they do. And I want you to pay close attention in the book to the places where it talks about how different societies define what people of different ages can do. You know, where is it appropriate to see an old person? Those are very important examples. I'll ask you about them on the test because they really show the differences between our culture and other cultures. Now, this went into, aging was included in the gender chapter, not only because it relates to women disproportionately, but because it refers to prejudice and discrimination. When this happens due to age, to anyone of any sex, is called ageism. When you treat someone in a biased way, or discriminate against them based on their age, that's called ageism. And as our aging population gets larger, then we see it more and more. There are now laws that seek to protect job seekers over 40 from discrimination. So this has become such a concern that it's being codified into law. Law is a great indicator of what's changing in society. Now, you can see the changes over time that I've been talking about in the box on page 311. But here's the box that most explains gender inequality. Switching back to gender real quick. The number of senators, U.S. senators, since 1789, since the Constitution was ratified, all of them, all senators since 1789, there were 2,000 men. How many women were there to date? 38. Now, we went through a revolution against the British for taxation without representation. In the Senate, women are clearly underrepresented, as are minority groups, other minority groups. So while we often, you know, hear that we have a pluralist country, when we look at the facts, it's not as pluralist as we think that it is. It's like we recognize diversity, but we don't look at the people who get to make the big decisions, decisions about whether we go to war, decisions about all kinds of social policy, health policy, social security, all kinds of things. All of these decisions are made without the adequate representation of minority groups. And that's what we mean by social power. So no, you know, no one is saying that, you know, just because you're a man, you have a lot of power. No, no. But if you happen to be an elite white man and you went to the right schools and your family connections got you into government or you were mentored into government, these are the people who end up in positions of power to make decisions. So I'm not saying that all men have power. I just wanted to clarify that. So you can read in the book about how conflict theory, functionalism, and symbolic interactionism deal with these. Do read it. I may pick something out of that for the test, but I'm not going to emphasize that in this chapter. I want you to particularly focus in this chapter on concept of sex versus gender, the spectrum of sex and gender, feminism, what it is, how do you define it, the cultural differences in gender. There's a section that spreads out with a lot of pictures of women working in India. Take a look at that. Read about differences in gender and aging around the world and expectations. So in closing, remember, sociologists by definition focus on the social. So we're interested in what's happening with gender and age in regards not to individual people's experience, but as a large group. Differences that show up in statistics. That's what we're interested in. Any one person can have a different life experience. You can be what's called in statistics the outlier, the piece of data that doesn't fit. And that's fine. But we're basing our assumptions on the majority of the data. Okay. So everybody's experience counts. Just try to think sociologically, bring it up to the macro level, and remember that we're concerned with large groups. Okay, until next week, I'll see you.